Let's pray. Father, we thank you for each one that's here today. Father, there's probably some here that have a need and haven't mentioned it. But Father, you know that need. You know what's going on in their life and what you're doing. So Father, we just pray that you would open doors for these people, Father, that need a touch from you. Whether it's sickness, Father, whether it's finances, whatever it might be. You're the God that cares for every need that we have. So, Father, we just come to you to humble ourselves. Father, forgive us of our sins and where we've fallen short. And, Father, we come against any power that would try to mess this service up, Father. To distract people. Father, we pray for the power of your Holy Spirit to touch our lives, to minister to us exactly where we need it, Father. So guide my lips. Father, be with those that are here to hear. Give them ears to hear what your Spirit is saying today. And Father, help us all to be obedient to what you have for each and every one of us. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, that's where we started off. Well, we finished up a little bit of repenting. People, we can't afford to have sin in our lives because it hinders everything that we try to do. God is a God of grace. But God also is a God of change, and He wants to change our lives and bring us to full maturity as brothers and sisters in Christ. And even with that, I think one of the last things that God works on us with is, well, dying to self, but that's probably number one, but letting us be used by His Spirit, letting us take the gift that God has given you and use it for the body of Christ. You know, sometimes people take the gifts of the Spirit and they abuse them because, and we talked about this a little bit last week, but they abuse them because they use them as weapons against people. Their pride thinks that they're more spiritual than anybody else in what they do. And there's another way that we go that is clear to the far the other way is that we don't think God wants to use us. And that's a biggest hindrance, just as big as using it the wrong way. And I want us to understand that the talent that God has given you, He's given you that for the body of Christ, whatever that might be. And so we need to understand that we need to be obedient to God in everything that we do, even when we're here. You could hear something from God that no one else is hearing. And I took you to chapter 14. Because I think that a lot of times we think that we have a thought on how the church should be done. And here in the first church, this is the way, and if you look at chapter 14, verse 26, what then shall we say, brothers? When you come together, everyone has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or interpretation, all of these must be done for the strengthening of the church. Okay? Everything we do here ought to strengthen the church, not tear it down. Amen? Amen. I heard one. So keep that in mind. You know, and that's the thing that we have to realize in our life. We're here to build one another up. And if you're holding out on me, you know, I had a word come to me this week and said that I'm going to heal your pancreas. And I says, I receive that, Lord. And I'm not going to let that go. And it wasn't even for me hearing it. It was somebody else telling me. And I said, Lord, I claim that in Jesus' name. You can just walk on and not do that. But see, if God is speaking to you about another person here in church, you need to realize that. And you need to be obedient. Whether you go to them after church or whether you go to them to the message and say, Pastor, I have something I need to share. But it better edify and it better build up the body of Christ. Amen? If you're hearing anything else, you need to bring it to me. Okay? Because it's too easy to tear down. How's come we can look at everybody else and see the problem? I got a problem going on right now. Okay? And I feel really bad about this. I got my hair cut and I got my hair cut and it was off. And somebody said, your hair's not right. So my loving wife said, I'll try to fix it. So she did. She was fixing it, and I'm sitting in the mirror watching her, and she's back there, and I'm going like this, and I think, that is perfect. And she went like this and dropped her hand, and this thing was still running, and she took a patch of my hair out over here. Now, a lot of people say, I never noticed it. I know it. And I think everybody's looking at me strange. But there's one thing that hit me when it happened. Kim, don't say nothing. She was trying to help you. And she feels so bad about it. You know? And that's the way we need to be in church with one another. Soon as I heard that, I thought, oh no, Lord. And she goes, whoops. Whoops! You hate that when you go to the dentist. And the dentist goes, whoops! But you know, I love her with all my heart, and it doesn't matter. But I'm afraid people are looking at me and thinking, what do you do to your hair?
She may get revenge after service.
Well, yeah. But I felt so bad for her. At the time, because she was just trying to help me. And then that happened. But we could go off the charts, 0 to 100 in 2 seconds. And we have to learn to control that and take every thought captive that's going on in our lives. You know, and you know the difference between a good haircut and a bad haircut? 3 weeks. Okay? And it's not a big deal. Nobody died. But the bottom line is, and we talked about this last, if we use our gifts and we don't show love, we're nothing. We're nothing. All we're trying to do is manipulate people with the gift. And that's not what God made him for. So all of us, even you, what God does in your life is between you and God. Okay? And I told you last week, this, it's been a long week, it seemed like a year. But I told you last time that God wants to use you in this body. And people wonder why I give people a chance to speak in the service, because you've got something, and if you're keeping it from us, God is saddened. Whether it's because you're too prideful, and you're using it the wrong way, or whether you've just decided you don't want to embarrass yourself. One is as bad as the other. God has given you a gift, and He's given it for the common good of the body of Christ. And if we don't use it that way, then some people in this body are going to lack because of what's not being said or done. Amen? And it starts with you. You can't change me. You can't change your spouse. The only one you can change is you. And if you're trying to do it without faith, if you're struggling in an area and you're not using faith, guess what? It's not going to work. Faith is what pleases God. And that's what makes the difference. And we need to use these gifts, these talents, whatever you want to call them. There are spiritual gifts. But if you're using them to manipulate people, you're wrong. Or to make people look bad. Now, there is a time when God might tell you something about somebody or a sin that they're in or something that's going on in their life. You go to them personally. Okay? What would you want done if it was you? All right? God has given us these gifts. And in chapter 4, and the reason that we're going through this is because for 1 Corinthians, all through it, God is, or Paul is correcting the church. And one of the things, big things they was having, and it always is speaking in tongues, and they thought they was more spiritual than the other people that didn't. And you know that happens. You know, all of us would like to play guitar like Rod. All of us would like to play like Glenna or Ann or anybody else that does it. We always want somebody else's gift. People, we gotta be that's the word I'm looking for. Content with what God has given you. Go back to chapter 12. First Corinthians chapter 12. And we talked about this, and this is the testing of the Spirit. Verse 3, therefore, I'm going to back up and go over this again. Some of you are going to get a repeat. But therefore, I tell you that no one is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except by the same Holy Spirit. Do you get that? You want to test the Spirit in somebody that you're not sure what's going on? You need to ask them, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? And if they're not of God, they will say, they won't say, I do. Okay? They will not confess that. But yet, the Word of God says, everybody says, Lord, Lord, is not going to enter into the kingdom of God. Why? Because of their hearts. And you see, God looks at your heart, not at your hair. I thought about just putting a big O there. And you guys would say, he's got another hole in his head.
Bullseye, right?
Bullseye. Verse 4, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service. Why does he say service? Because some of you serve other people. There's things you can do for God. And they're from the same Spirit. You just got something different than I got. I got straight hair. You may have curly hair. How come people with straight hair always want curly hair, and people with curly hair always want straight hair? And people that don't have hair want hair. I knew I had to throw that in. Different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. For what? The gift that you use is for the common good. Okay? Not the common teardown. But if you're going to talk to somebody about a problem you have with them, then you need to go Matthew 18:15, I think it is, or 15:18. You need to go to them by yourself and talk to them. But usually when God has us here, and He even tells us in chapter 14, use the gifts that are gonna build up. And them are always used out of love. Okay? And that's the whole thing. It needs to be done in love. Everything we do, everything Jesus done for you was out of love. Everything God has ever done for you is out of love. Even when He disciplines us, takes us to the woodshed. You ever been there with God? How many of you ever argued with God? How'd that work out? We learned something, but it's usually something that we need to know that we're not seeing. So God wants to change us. But people, He wants to use you in everything that happens here. It's just not about me. It's about God speaking to you and using you and the gifts that need to be given. You know, I remember, and I'm sure that some of you was here that day. When a word was given to Barb by Kelly. And she turned around and talked right to her. But the whole church heard it. And it was a good report. Because Barb had been diagnosed with cancer. Now see, God can use you in any way if you're willing and obedient. And if we say God doesn't speak to us, then why do we serve Him? Think about that. You know, in the old days, and even talks about this in Corinthians, that they made idols that looked like a god. They made them of calves. Remember the calf that was made? The golden calf? They just happened to throw the gold in a fire and it come out a calf. Just happened that way. You know, but we got gods we serve. It's everything that you're putting before God. Television? Whatever. But the bottom line is, God wants to use you. And He can speak to your heart. And you just need to be obedient. You may not even understand what God's doing. Verse 8. To one there is given the spirit of message of wisdom. To another, the message of knowledge by means of the same spirit. To another, faith by the same spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the same spirit. To another, miraculous powers. And to another, prophecy. Prophecy can be proclaiming the future, something that's going to happen, or it can be just preaching the Word of God. Amen? You're proclaiming it to somebody else. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different tongues, of different kinds of tongues. And to another, interpreting tongues. All of these are the work of one and the same Spirit. And He gives them to each one, just as He determines. Who's He? I asked you this last week. Who's He? God. Who are you to tell God you don't want that? Or who are you to tell God? And it tells us in here to seek and desire the gifts of the Spirit and desire to serve God in whatever capability that you have. I look at Kevin and I think administration. I look at Rod, administration. I look at other people, teachers. I can look at your face and all of a sudden God tells me, and it's not because he's really speaking to me, but it comes to me, the gift that you're already working in, and you don't even receive it. You don't see it as a gift. Somebody asked me after the sermon, well, what do you think my gift is? And I looked at them and said, why would you say that? You know what it is. Each and every one of us. You're already doing it. You just may not be doing it here. If it's prayer, Lee and Pat, and a lot of you, are prayer warriors. But you think, that's not a big deal. But God said right here, He give it to you. He give you straight hair. He give you curly hair. He give you the personality that you've got and was built because even the hard things that you've been through, God has been there in the midst. He knew it was going to happen before it happened. And it's usually the sin of men that caused those things to happen. 90% of the foster kids, we had over 70 kids, 90% of them was sexually abused. Messed them up. Big time. And someday somebody's going to give an account for that. But even through those hard times, God changes us. God builds us. God strengthens us. We may not like it when it's going on, but He's doing it. Well, why did God let it happen to me? I don't know. Why did my wife cut my hair the way it is? I know she didn't do it on purpose, but somebody sinned against you when they did what they did. So that makes the Bible true, right? All of us are sinners. But what God is doing with you now is a mighty work. And you know something? A lot of times we just have to give up and say, take it, God. I can't handle it anymore. You know? Are you willing to trust God with your problems? Are you willing to trust God with the gift that He's given you? I didn't want to be a preacher. I said when I was young, I remember I couldn't been in, I wasn't even in first grade, I don't think, I don't know for sure, but it was back in those days. And I sat with my dad on Sunday night in church and just looked at that preacher and I thought, I could never do that. Don't say it out loud. And some of you think the things that God's given you, you don't know how it's going to work out. Well, I didn't either. Just roll with the punches. Just bless God. Keep God. Just keep a hold of Him. He'll get you through it. Don't give up on Him, because if you give up on Him, you've given up on the only hope that you have. Amen? Yes.
Word, water. to me recently, it's like you're standing in a bunch of waters now. And I have more people around my life that are involved in my life, or I'm embarrassed, than I ever had before. So that does work.
Amen. And faith, you may not understand the word somebody gives you. You know, I've called out a couple of these young people, and they ain't got a clue what I'm talking about. They don't even know what's going to happen. But I know by faith that God is going to use those people in a mighty way. And I can look at you, and some of you are just hindering yourself in your spiritual growth because you are saying no to God. Not me as a pastor. You are saying no to God. I will not do that. You take that up with God. You may not see how you could ever do it, but God has a way of putting you where He needs you, putting people around you that you need to make a difference in your life. And you might even make a difference in somebody else's life and not even know it. But that's how God works. He puts you around people. He puts you with people that are going to make a difference in your life. The devil puts you around people that are going to tear you down and destroy you. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And if you don't know that, you're going to let him do it. You got to stand by faith. I don't care if you got a disease, if you got whatever's going on in your life. You have to believe that God can do something about that thing and make a way. That's faith. Not just accepting what is there. You know, when Peter stepped out of the boat, he didn't start sinking until he started looking around at all the waves. And that's what happens to us. Even if my sugar goes high, I'm still believing God. You said God. And I'm claiming that. And I don't care if you do it in a year, a day, a week. Do it. Hang on to His promises. What He has for you. And if He doesn't do anything, His grace is sufficient for all of us. Are you going to serve Him whether He takes that thing out of your life or not? You've got to make your mind up before that. That I don't care what happens to me, God, I'm going to serve You. Whether you heal me or you don't heal me. Because I know you got the best. Verse 12. This is where I wanted to get going. The body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts. And though all of its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. Why would he say that? Because we're the body of Christ. He lives in us. His Holy Spirit resides in our hearts. We are the temple. Remember when the curtain was torn, when Jesus died? That curtain was torn. That opened up each and every one of us so that we could let the Holy Spirit live in us. That's a miracle. In your everyday things, you have that battle of your mind and your heart. You need to understand, one is from God, one isn't. And you need to decipher that right away. If it's tearing you down and everything, it's probably not God. If it's building you up, even if you've sinned, people get caught in a sin and they think God will never use them again. That is a lie from hell. If that was true, I wouldn't be standing here today. And if that's true in your life, you need to understand that God is a forgiving God. And go back to what we've studied for a month or so or two. Repent. Turn towards God. Turn towards His ways, and He will cause things to change in your life. You like your life the way it is right now? If you don't like it, you think the devil's winning, turn closer to God. Get as close as you can to Him. Because as you draw near to him, he will draw near to you. And sometimes we don't even know how to draw near. Meditate, be in his word. Think about his ways, his concepts. We're going through that in Sunday school. You need to come. It's a real learning. Everybody gets asked questions. If you don't want to read or talk, that's fine. You don't have to. But I guarantee you, they'll come. Everybody that's come to Sunday school said, I wasn't going to say anything, but, you know, God's talking about me. And that needs to be what's going on in our lives here today. We're a part of the body. We're a part of Christ. We're a part of the church. Every part has its reasons why it's there. And every part has something to give. Your nose, you can smell good things and bad things. And with your mind, you know what's good and what's bad. Smells. Your ears. And he goes through this whole thing and even talks about it. Verse 13. We were all baptized into one spirit, into one body, whether Jew or Greeks or slave or free, and we are all given the one spirit to drink. And that's Jesus, his spirit that lives in us. You all got him. It's how close you get to him that's going to make the difference. It's how real you make him in your world. And honor and open up things for him. And you can listen to him. Have you ever talked to somebody that you really don't want to listen to? And you don't listen, really? The biggest thing in your mind is, I just wish they would get done. That pastor, he talks all the time. You forget, you're paying me to do this. That's your bad. But the bottom line is, we can tune things out or we can tune in. And you can tune God out or you can tune him in. You can accept him or you can reject him. He gives you free choice. You can live for him or you don't have to. You can give him your whole body, all your members, to serve him, or you don't have to. That's up to you. But don't you expect to see what you think you want from God and not serve him. Not surrender. Because it's not going to happen. You draw nigh to him and he will draw nigh to you. We come into the service and we do praise and worship. If you get tired, sit down. If you can't stand, stay seated. God knows. It doesn't matter. But the reason that we do this is because we all carry baggage around from every week we go through. How many of you had things happen good to you this week? I did. How many of you had bad things happen to you? Now, which one do you remember the most? Huh? The good you should. Good you should. But sometimes the enemy wants to bring the bad in. To why? To make you feel miserable. If you have depression, guess what you're thinking about all the time? The bad things. You've lost hope. And you've got to start centering in on the good things that God has given you. To know that he is in your life and he has given you things to do and things that we need to do for him and for each other. Verse 14. Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. And if a ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. You know what? You're a part of the body of Christ. You just got to figure out which part you are and then do it. Just because I stand up here doesn't make me any more important than you. Whether you're in the praise team, whether you're not in the praise team, whether you're just sitting there learning and want to get full of Jesus, or whether God has had you serve with the youth, you are not any less. The only thing, and it goes into this, the only thing about me, I get to stand up in front of all you. How many of you want that job? There's days I'll give it to you. But just because I'm seen more doesn't make me more important. Okay? Because there's a lot that goes on behind the scenes to make this happen every day. Somebody's running the sound. Somebody comes in and does the bulletin. Somebody prints the bulletins out. Somebody prepares it. And somebody else runs them through the copier. Somebody passes it out. Do you see what he's getting at here? Just because you're not seen all the time doesn't mean you're not important to God. Because God is going to use you the way he made you to be. And we just read that. So don't hold back on God. I want to go to Peter, 1 Peter. Now that we've gotten this far. 1 Peter chapter 4. And then we'll close. That's what you always say. I just said it before one of you did. Verse 10. Well, let's go to verse 7. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sin. What conquers sin? Love. So when somebody sins against you, what do you have to do? Love. Hello? Now there's principles in the Bible. If you need money, what should you do? Ask. What else? Give. Work. Who said that? Yeah. Exactly. You don't work, you don't eat. Okay? But the bottom line is, there's principles in the Bible. You have to do the opposite of what you want, usually. If you're needing finances, you need to give. I don't seem right. I ain't got it to give. Then don't. Let me know how that turns out. Okay? Somebody asked me. I was talking with somebody about something. Always am. But I was talking to somebody, and they told me about something in their life. And I said, how's that working for you? Not good. And I never thought of that. And well, you know, we keep doing the same thing the same way, and guess what happens? The same thing. If you want life to change, you got to do something that God's Word tells you to do. Because love covers a multitude of sin, and that's what Jesus did on the cross. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Without what? Grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. And you are the various forms. Use the gift that God has given you to what? To serve others. Not yourself. And we got to quit coming to church thinking that I want to find out an answer. That's good. But we got to start coming to church and say, God, who can I be the answer to today? Who can I help? What do you got for me to do today? You know, I was on vacation, and then there's a guy, and every time I see him, I just think of him. You know, he's always the last one. They have a campfire. You know what he does when he first gets there? He goes and gets the water and sets it up for the guy that's going to throw the thing on. Anybody needs a chair? He goes and gets the chair. Anybody needs anything else? He goes and does it. His wife comes, he gets his chair, sets it up for her, gets it all ready for her. What if everybody served? It'd be a better world, wouldn't it? You're either a taker or a giver. Which are you? And that's what God, he wants us to be, a giver. Because he is a giver. He was a giver. And he gave his only begotten son to die on a cross for you and for me. And what are we withholding from the church? The whole body. We're going to finish this. But what I want us to realize is that you're just as important to this body as I am. Or anybody else that's on the board. And the bottom line is, when you're involved in the church and you're doing something, usually you're doing it for other people and you get a crowd around you, the people that are doing something for the church. And then everybody says, we got cliques. No, we got servers. The ones that are doing the work and the ones that aren't doing the work. And of course, the relationships are going to draw each other in. And there are cliques, there are this, there are personalities that just get along. And there's personalities that don't get along. You ever run into somebody and think, whoa, I'm not sure about that person? I get that all the time. People saying they're not sure about me. But the bottom line is, you a giver or are you a taker? And to be doing what God wants us to be is that we need to become givers. There's a lot of things that need to be done. People take care of the bulletins. People take care of, well, not too much landscaping lately because Ralph left when they moved. You know, and you know my theory on landscaping? You know what it is? Roundup. Or fake Roundup. So if you don't like that, then take my job from me, okay? You know what's something that's the funny thing about it is that we can find wrong in everybody if you look hard enough. But are we looking hard enough to find the good that they do? Do you know who most of the are? Do you know who gets this already? You know, somebody said something to me one time and I said, you know something? Preachers are a dime a dozen. I said, now the church can't do without Steve. And I tell Steve that. Because so many times I don't know what to do, but Steve does. It's good to have a Steve. You know what? Even Pastor Gary tries to use my Steve. I said, you get your hands off of him. Isn't it great how we become possessive? Dan. Oh, you know, I go through the whole thing. And hopefully they're close to me because I know they're doing something. And I give them input, they give me input. Now before we close, I want to say this to you. You know, I called quite a few people that haven't been here this week in quite a while and just see if they're busy or what's going on. But you know what? You can do that. If you see, there's no law written that the pastor has to do that. And there's no, whatever it might be, is God calling you to do that? You know, I would like somebody, one of the men, to take over the men's meeting. You know, Sherry's teaching. I teach on Wednesday nights. Doesn't mean I have to teach every Wednesday night. Sherry's working with the women. Steve's just doing everything. David and Dan run the sound. If you want to learn any of these things, just ask. Because we have to take ownership of the body of Christ and Christ's building. Amen? If you don't like our bushes with flat tops out there, then I'll recruit you. But what I'm saying is, take ownership. Take ownership. What has God gifted you to do that you enjoy doing and that you see that we have a need for that? And it could be something we're not even doing. We have Meals on Wheels. You want to help out with that? Usually you don't have to drive. But all you have to do is help carry, go with somebody and help carry food to people. And they ask you to pray for them. We're not supposed to, but as long as they ask, I'm not going to say no. But the bottom line is, what has God given to you to give to others? Amen? Even in the service, people, if you've got a testimony, whatever God is doing. You know, I just was between, when I talked to my daughter this week, I was between crying and laughing so hard at the enemy. And it's worth waiting for when it happens. Amen? So don't sit on your gift. It's there to be used by other people. If you enjoy praying, there's a prayer list. If you need more, I got more. I got a lot of unspoken needs that are confidential. But you need to find out what God has for you as the body of Christ. You could do something to, and another thing, we're looking for somebody to run the clothing thing. If you want to help out with that, let me know. But if not, I'm going to take it somewhere where it can be used. And I know there's a place. But what is God speaking to your heart? Take time this week to find out what God wants you to do for the body of Christ. Not for the pastor, but for Him. Because we ought to be working like we're working to the Lord. Not our bosses. But God watches everything we do. Amen? Do you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior? Have you ever accepted Him? It's right in the bulletin. The confession that you need to make at the bottom of the page on your right-hand side. If you've never done that, I'm sorry, but you're going to hell. And it's not because you're not a good person. You might be. But you can't get into heaven unless you know Jesus. Amen? And we've got a lot of people in our lives that don't know Jesus, and that's our job. To show them hope. And that hope is Jesus Christ. No matter what they're going through, God can turn it around. But we have to surrender to Him for salvation. We have to make Him Lord of our life. Have you done that? Maybe you've accepted Jesus, but you just haven't given Him full reign. You know, after we get done with the pork chop dinner, I'm going to put on the, I heard this a few weeks ago, God is still writing your story. Quit stealing the pen. Amen? You can do it your way. But if you do it God's way, it's going to be a lot more fruitful. Amen? Let's stand our feet. If you don't know Jesus, don't leave here. Come up to me. Tell me you want to do that. It's written down. That's all you have to do is say, believe that in your heart, confess it with your mouth, and the Bible says you're saved. Then you follow along with obedience and baptism and all the things that God is trying to make you to be. And if you never search that out, God's not going to be alive. You know, most of the reason that we don't see God move in our lives is us. Because we keep getting in the way and don't do it the way God wants. Amen? Ouch. So if you don't know Him, don't leave here without Him. You need Him. You may die tomorrow. Who knows? Remember Harold was here that Sunday? First time he spoke in church, that afternoon, he went to be with Jesus. Which one of us would have thought that was going to happen? I miss Harold. And all the rest of them that's went to be with him. They just, it takes a part out of our lives. And you know what? If you're not doing what God's called you, you're taking a part out of other people's lives. Something that you could encourage and help them with. That's between you and God. Amen? So search your heart this week. Ask God, get alone with Him and just ask Him, what do you have for me, God? Is there something you want me to do for you? I dare you to say that. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for each one that's here today. We thank You for Your presence, Your Spirit, Father. We thank You for the visitors we've got. Father, we just pray that You would continue to bless them. And Father, use us as vessels of honor throughout this week to people that we come into contact with. Father, be with those that are at the fair and cleaning up and moving back home. We pray that You would watch over them and keep them. Now, Father, bless each one as we leave this place. Guide and direct them, Father, throughout the week. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Greet two or three people and you're dismissed.